Emmanuel College for this in one of our series of intellectual property law lectures. I'm Fiona Reynolds, the master companion by many of you here tonight. And I'm delighted to introduce Professor Alain Strowel from the University of Louvain. Alain is one of those people who, when you read his CV, you realise what an incredible, broad education he's had. I think 3 degrees, beginning with law, economics, and philosophy. In the 1980s, I think, gives you a picture of the breadth of his interest, followed by a year at the University of Amsterdam studying European economics. From that broad base, he then turned towards copyright law, which, of course, as you know, a fast-changing area of law shaped by technology and the internet, which is very much, I think, going to be the theme of his discussions tonight. He then embarked on a PhD at the Catholic University of Louvain, and is also a practicing lawyer at Brussels Bar from 1988. And his thesis was on authors' rights and copyrights, and I imagine that also will shape some of his discussions this evening. And today he lectures at the University of Louvain, but also is a professor at the Brussels Faculty Université Saint-Louis, and also teaches at Maastricht and at Munich, so again, has multiple and diverse interests, as well as continuing to work in private practice on IP and information technologies. So tonight he's going to talk to us, as you can see, about big data in a platform economy and need to redesign the rules. Professor Lever.
Thank you very much for the introduction and the invitation. It's a pleasure to be here, and I hope we'll have a good discussion, because my intention is just to initiate maybe a discussion with you during this presentation and afterwards. I was asked by Lionel to do something outside of copyright, and to do something that might interest people outside the law. So I came up with this proposal, which now I think is a little bit bold, but okay. It was too late, so it's too late today, and I will have to deal with it. Sorry, of course, because it will be probably very superficial. Because, of course, to deal with the issue of big data, which might involve things which are very complicated. I don't know whether they are data scientists here or engineers in the room. The platform economy is something very complex for economists too, so I won't be able to go deep in the analysis. And of course, the rules that I want to cover are very different, and I'm not an expert for all the different types of rules that I will review. So it's a very general overview, the aim of which is just to introduce a discussion, and of course with the final more policy-oriented questions, whether there is a need to redesign the rules. But first of all, maybe something that you know, but in a way it's a background of my talk today. A well-known quote of Stewart Brand, about what information is, about information which wants to be free, and it's very strange to equate information with a human being, with an intention, but it seems for him there is a push towards freedom, and at the same time, information wants to be expensive. It's cheap to aggregate, to distribute, to recombine, but many people want to have it expensive as well. And that tension, according to Stewart Brand, will remain. It leads to endless debate about pricing, about copyright, intellectual property, and even moral issues. And I think what I want to present today is the kind of complexities between the need for freedom in relation to data and information, and as well the fact that there are a very strong push to make it expensive and rare. So let's start with big data. And I'll start with some features, some facts, and then move on by distinguishing different types of data. So big data is usually qualified by the three V's. It's different than data before because in terms of volume, the amount is very different. We have to deal with data which are very different. So variety is the second characteristics. And there is a speed as well in the world of big data, which makes it impossible for the traditional data analysis to deal with it because of those new complexities. When you look at recent reports, like the one produced by the House of Commons quite recently, in February, I'll come back in a minute on what they mean by the dilemma of big data. But obviously it's something which is important for the economy in terms of jobs, in terms of GDP. You see the number there. So there is obviously an economic challenge. I think the legal discussion around big data usually focuses around personal data. But as put there, personal data is only probably a small part of big data. So I will discuss some personal data issues, but discuss other issues. But at least it's clear, it's important, and in this report, there is a kind of distinction of the value added that economic data or big data could bring to the UK economy, sector by sector, starting with numbers. I think there are three types of data and probably different owners of the data which make big data. Public data, of course, is one important part. I already mentioned personal data. And then, as well, to privately owned data. If you look at public data, for instance, it seems, according to the report, that in the UK there are a lot, more than 20,000 data sets, which are now open data, published and accessible, according to the terms of some license. Personal data, it's huge. It's huge. It's, for instance, every minute more than 200 million emails sent, 4 million Google search requests, and more than 2 million Facebook posts. So it's big. And I put it here on the side of personal data. But of course, it appears as well in the treasure of some companies, usually. Concerning the data produced by the public sector, where there has been a trend in favor of open data, I think in different countries, and clearly in this country, the governments realize that it's as important as other infrastructure. It's not to navigate to places, as the Open Data Institute says, but it helps to navigate to decisions. And that makes it probably a valuable asset, big data, if, of course, it helps us to navigate. In order to share, there is, and some of you might know much more than I do, on the Open Government License, which helps to access this data. And I was struck when reading the report about the effect that the release of some information about transport on London had as an effect, because more than 5,000 designers registered to use the data sets made available under this open license, and it led to the creation, as you can see, of more than 360 apps. I don't know whether you are using some of them, but it's impressive in terms of outcome. When you read the report on, I mean, the implementation, the deployment of open data, it appears that there are some problems and some elements which are more complicated. It's the definition of the process, the policies, and the standards for this open and shared data. And that's where the problem is. The problem is not so much, of course, in the data. And I think that's as well the legal issue. The legal issue is more about the structure, the standards for data. On the other side, so personal data owned by individuals, there it's clear that there is a dilemma, and I think the title of this House of Lords report comes from that. People are concerned about their online privacy, but at the same time they are happy with the amount of information that they share. Of course, those two polls which I quote there are made by a very different association, and that might explain the outcome. But nevertheless, I think it's correct, this ambivalence of people towards the use of their personal data. It's there, and I think even if the commissioners of those two polls are different, it's correct. Now, when we refer to private data or to data by the private sector, it seems that data sharing, of course, is there more complicated, and that there is quite a lot of friction. So, behind my talk here, I think one of the challenges is to find ways to encourage data sharing among those private undertakings, because that has quite a positive effect on the economy. But of course, it's not that easy, because individuals have as well some rights on part of this information. But we'll come back on to ways to restrict access to this information on companies using contracts or intellectual property. Big data became clearly an intangible asset. It's even described sometimes as a new asset class. And it makes it similar to what I've been studying, so the value protected by intellectual property rights. But it's not yet on the balance sheet. It's not on the balance sheet, but it seems when you look at some reports, and I refer here to an interesting graphic which was published last week in the Financial Times about, you cannot see it probably, about the trends in global trade. It seems that since 2007, concerning the flows of goods, services and finance in the world, we have reached a kind of plateau, and there is even a slowdown recently in terms of global trade. But at the same time, when you compare, and I think that was interesting in this article, when you compare that with the rise of global data flows, and on the left side you have the data for 2005, on the right side down you have the data for 2014, there is an increase which is staggering. Interestingly as well, it seems that there is some kind of regional circulation of data, and probably it's like for other aspects of trade. So within Europe, that's a big round there. We are exchanging information with other countries coming from Europe, which probably indicates the position where we are here and in other countries in Europe. Okay, that was on big data, some facts. Now, the platform economy, and that's even bolder, because nobody knows exactly whether platform is just a buzzword or whether it corresponds to a new economic reality. I was just discussing with the master before entering the room, and she referred to the fact that at the BBC there was some kind of thinking about moving towards a platform. platform seems to be at least everywhere into language, and in particular in Brussels of decision makers. I will say a word on that, and then I will briefly discuss, but I'm not really an economist, what a multi-sided market is for economists and what that could imply, especially in terms of competition law analysis. So maybe here you haven't heard about the GAFA. GAFA, that's not a word in common language, but it is now in certain countries, especially in France, especially in Paris. The GAFA are probably targeted by some politicians. And part of the debate on platform, of course, is probably partly explained by some political issues that not only in France, but that decision makers as well in Germany. And I think on that issue there is a real convergence between Germany and France. At least there is a lot of doubts about the world that the GAFA are preparing for us in Europe. And of course, when you look at what they call the ecosystem, basically it's a platform. Google is a platform with many different services, and when you enter the platform, usually you stick to the platform, you don't move out, because it's so easy to remain associated with different services like the one you see there. And know that those companies like Google are moving outside to pure web services, but they are coming into other industry sectors with the connected car, with the Nest acquisition, that's the Nest thermostat, which is an interesting tool to get a lot of data inside the house, the glasses and so on. I think that raises really some concerns, not only within the economic sectors, but it has reached the level of politicians clearly in France and in Germany. It's not the case in other countries. Last May, you might know that the Commission came with a strategy, and it's called the Digital Single Market Strategy, which is the kind of program for the next years in terms of digital policy for the Commission and the EU institutions. So there were a lot of discussions on that, and for instance you see here someone to which the question is addressed: in the context of the digital single market, what's your take on platform regulation? And of course here the response from this person is, well, it's not useful and it doesn't mean anything, because in the end we are all platforms. Well, the BBC at least seems to think it is a platform. So it's not only Google. Of course, that's what someone from Google says. So they don't like too much. But probably they are right as well that we should be very careful about this new notion which comes in to debate and maybe in the future into law. In fact, in France, there is already a law protecting consumers which contains a definition, a legal definition of a platform. But we don't have to do French law here. So, yes, I think indeed. That's maybe to sign that it's not the right word. But when you look at what the Commission says in its strategy, it's quite positive about platforms, because platforms enable consumers to find information and a lot of business to exploit e-commerce. You see here a list, which is an open list of platforms, search engines among social media, app stores, price comparison websites. I think it covers probably too many realities and too different entities for an adequate regulation to be defined, but that's my view. At least they came with this broad list of illustration of what a platform is. The Commission thinks that there are very good things and things which are not that good with platforms. They have a multiplier effect in fostering new SMEs, and I think that's the case as well with the exploitation of big data. And platforms are probably the best equipped to use and exploit big data, but there are others. SMEs can do the same. That has a lot of benefits in terms of efficiency for the consumer choice, but of course they accumulate a lot of personal data and they use algorithms. Is it new? Not sure. And of course for the Commission, and that's probably where there might have been some political push, some platforms have a growing market power, and the Commission concludes that maybe some further analysis, if not some regulation, is needed beyond the application of competition law in specific cases. So I cannot go into the details of what a platform or a multi-sided platform is, but there are economists, including the Nobel Prize, the French Nobel Prize, Jean Tirole, who have been working on multi-sided platforms, which are probably different than other markets, because you have different sides in the case of a platform. You have users and advertisers, and you have a lot of effects, a lot of network effects. I mean, this is the kind of functioning, summarized, of those which are offering free services, where you have two sides, the users and the advertisers, and you have free service, and another part is a pet part of the market. In case you have a multi-sided market, usually there are those external effects, like a cross-site effect. That means that a member of one group values more the interaction when the participation of another group increases, and that's clearly the fact for advertiser. If the number of users to which they can sell advertising grows, so that's a positive cross-site. There might be as well external effect within one side of the multi-sided market. That's quite obvious that the value for a member of one group increases if the number of people participating to that side increases. But that is positive in terms of participation to a multi-sided market like a social network for the users, maybe not on the other side, for the advertisers, of course. So you might have positive or negative external effects within one side or cross side, and those different effects makes the economic analysis probably more complicated in terms, for instance, of assessing the dominance because of the different effects. But at least those platforms seem to be very positive because they help us to do things that we would never be able to do through a bilateral relationship, because they reduce the transaction costs. Of course, there are many types of multi-sided platforms, and here you have some examples. I don't go into the details, but it should show that for economists, this notion makes sense and can apply to different types of economic operators. It could even cover matchmakers, not only to find a job on the market, but as well to find a partner. And most media, of course, that's probably the case of the BBC, most media have two sides because they have the users and the advertiser side. All the actors of the sharing economy are probably working on a multi-sided market as well. So all the debate, and it's very fashionable to speak about sharing economy, I saw that there are now theories, at least in America, articles on the law platform as well, but it's more focused on the sharing economy. So there are so many different types of platform. That's not interesting to go more into details, but when you look at this slide, it's interesting. Something interesting is happening in the economy, of course. I mean, it's itself explanatory, so I don't have to go into details. What is happening? What is this interesting, maybe, development in the economy? Well, you become big because you just have the data, and you are in between the two sides of the market. So data becomes very important in this kind of digital platform economy. I was looking at the way the UK government responded to the EU public consultation on digital platforms, because after the DSM strategy was released last year, the Commission came in autumn with a consultation. And at the same time, the House of Lords conducted as well consultation about digital platforms. And when you look at the policy paper of the UK government and look at the headings, well, what's the common denominator? The whole discussion is about data. It's all about data, and I think we are probably at a moment where there is more to do to understand how the rules on data should function and should be designed. Now, that's the more legal part of my talk. What about the rules? I will deal with competition law a little bit, then focus more on intellectual property, because probably there are people interested in intellectual property law here today, and very little about data protection because time is passing. And then I will conclude on the need, maybe, to adapt the rules. Competition law first. And the role of data in competition law, I will come back on all cases. It's always nice to come back on sometimes very old cases, like the McGill case that we have been following, at least I did it in the mid-90s. It's a UK case, but there have been other cases, which I will just summarize, because they involve competition law, IP, and the access to data. And I will then end up with some comments on new developments. McGill, you might remember, some of you, but as I think it's a mixed audience, I come back on the facts. Sorry for those who know everything about this case. It's about the issue of a secondary market for weekly TV magazines, because at that time it seems that each broadcaster, including the BBC, had its own weekly magazine, and they refused to give a license to McGill, who wanted to publish a multi-channel guide. At that time there were only weekly guides per channel. Of course, the information was released to daily newspapers. That was not an issue. But they wanted to keep the secondary market for weekly magazine. McGill, in this case, complains before the DG Competition, the Commission, which issued a decision back in 1988. At the same time, there are discussions before the courts, and the Irish court finds that copyright subsists in the material. And the material, it's the titles, dates, and times. That's a piece of the original case, which I got from one of the lawyer, an English lawyer, who was involved. But of course, we could take any TV listings that we can still find today. So, the question is whether is IP protection on that. There, of course, there might be some difference between the continent and the UK, at least at that time. But there was a decision of the Irish court saying that there is a copyright. Maybe not all courts on the continent would conclude that there is a copyright on such a thing, because it's all about information. The court of first instance, as it was called at that time, concluded that the refusal to license was preventing the production of a new product for which there was a potential consumer demand and was excluding all competition, which was basically an abuse of dominant position, the dominant position being reinforced by the IP rights. Reinforced, because in this case, you not only have the rights, but of course each broadcaster is as well the sole source of information. Nobody else can access this information except the broadcast, because they are mastering their program. So there is no way around in this case. But the Court of Justice in this case confirms that in exceptional circumstances, so when there is a monopolization of a downstream market and the prevention of a new product for which there is a consumer demand, then there is an abuse if you refuse to grant a license. Of course, that was a case where the material did not present much creativity. Then the other case, which is an important case for refusal to license IP rights, involved IMSLs. IMSLs is a large provider of data service. They sell data to pharma industry. And the problem here is with a competitor, NDC, which wants to get some part of that market. IMS developed a so-called brick structure. It was called the 1860 brick structure, which had become the standard for delivering the data to the pharma industry. And the question was whether there was a possibility to refuse to grant a license on the use of this brick structure. It's a complicated procedure because there have been cases before the German courts, and at the same time, the competitor, LDC, made a complaint before DG Competition with the decision of the Commission in 2001. But a German court then asked for a preliminary ruling on the conditions for refusal to license to be abusive under competition law. And that was this brick structure. Here, don't start to count them, but you have 1860. So 1860 different areas covering the German territory. Basically, the information had to be factored in this database. And it seems it was not that easy to find a balance between going too much into disaggregation of information, because then there might be privacy issue if you know how many product is sold in this pharmacy and prescribed by that doctor. So that goes too far because of the requirement of German privacy law. So you have to aggregate a little bit of data, but it must still be valuable and give valuable information to the pharmaceutical company. So IMS developed with the pharmaceutical company this brick structure, and they refused to give a license. For the Commission, that's an essential facility, and it's a kind of de facto industry standard which creates a lot of switching costs if the customers, that is the pharmaceutical companies, have to change. They have to change completely their reporting system, their database, so it's a huge cost for them. No, yeah, I cannot go too much into details here, but it's different. I won't discuss the Volvo-Venn case, which is an early decision on the same issue, refusal to license in the case of design parts for cars. But when you compare it with the McGill requirement, in McGill, there need to be two markets, an upstream market and then some monopolization of a downstream market. But here, it's not clear that there are two markets. In fact, there is only one product for which there is maybe no market as such, because the brick structure is not sought. What is sought is the information that has to be embedded in this structure. So nobody is interested by the brick structure as such. So that's different as well from the McGill case. And then the ECJ in 2004 comes with the criteria for the refusal to be abusive. So first of all, there should be some form of indispensability. When is a license from the right owner indispensable for a competitor to compete? And that's a discussion about switching cost. But of course, if there are switching costs, they are probably cost first for the dominant firm when it establishes position on the market. And I think you have to take that into account as well. And then to of course add something about the circumstance when the refusal is abusive, when you reserve to market, and that was based on copyright, as well on the database right, and that this reservation eliminates all competition on the market. Of course, here there is, as we saw, no downstream market as such, and the competitor intends to offer new products not offered by the copyright owner, and there is no objective justification. I think that's still the criteria applied in Europe, including in more recent cases like the Microsoft case. Now, another area of competition law merger decisions. One of the issues there is to define what dominance is. And of course, in order to assess whether a company is dominant, you need to define the relevant market, and in particular, the relevant product market. That would be where there is some substitutability, for instance, for the consumers. Again, I'm a little bit careful there because I know that there are experts and I'm not an expert in competition law, but I think we are not yet there in terms of the definition of the relevant market for data. At least in a merger decision like the Facebook-WhatsApp decision of 2014, the Commission concluded that there is no possibility to define a market because there is, in fact, no market. Because the data is not traded by those companies. Well, WhatsApp even does not collect personal data. Facebook collects a lot of personal data, but they don't sell directly to data. They use it to serve targeted ads, but it's on behalf of the advertiser. They don't sell their database to the advertiser. So there is a difficulty to define a relevant product market for data in this case, because data is only an input, an intermediary product. It's different in other cases because other companies, like Twitter, they sell the data. And that's an example of all the personal and other data associated with a tweet. Cannot go into details there, but you have a lot of information associated with a tweet that has some value, it appears, because they sold the tweets to some data aggregators. So here it's different. Here you have a real market, but with other platforms like Google, Amazon, their privacy policies explains explicitly that they don't sell the data to third parties. So, a lot of discussion about the economic nature of data. In principle, it's non-rivalrous in the sense that the fact that one entity has a lot of data does not preclude others from gathering the same information. The fact is as well that the same knowledge derived from the data usually can be extracted from other types of data. So, in principle, it's not rivalrous, but in practice, companies are using different ways to exclude competitors to access the data. They might use contracts and the terms of use, I'll say more on that, or by using IP rights. So, I think we are at a moment where there is a discussion, and it's an open discussion about there is something like data dominance. In the case companies are gathering data that they don't really sell to other companies. And you might have seen that last week, that's quite interesting, the Bundeskartellamt started an investigation against Facebook. I think this procedure will probably show some light whether data has to be factored in the competition analysis, although they focus more on the terms of use of the social network, which seems to be abusive in the sense that they are imposing unfair terms, according to the Bundeskartellamt in their press release of last week. And if this abusive practice results in market dominance, there might be a problem from the competition point of view. Okay, I think I have to move on, time is passing. Let's move to intellectual property law and how it affects data. I mean, that's a complex diagram, sorry for that. But I think it's good to be reminded about the tension between the different rights on information and the different freedoms to information. And of course, when dealing with data, we have to find the good balance in between the two. So intellectual property, of course, is about restricting the access to information, not to data as such. It's always a qualified information in terms of an invention or a work protected by copyright and so on. But it's a way to restrict the access, that's quite clear. And I will here discuss some aspects in relation to data. So copyright, database rights, trade secret, which are clearly part, I think, of intellectual property, although trade secret is a bit different than the predefined IP rights that you see on the left side. Data protection, in a way, works similarly to some intellectual property rights. I think big data in the space of intellectual property might be covered by issues involving trade secret, as I said, copyright, data protection, and we have on those issues different regulation in the pipeline at different stage. I will discuss the revision of copyright exceptions. We are not yet very far. I would briefly mention the trade secret directive, which will be adopted soon, probably, and the general data protection regulation, which was adopted. There was a political agreement last December. So, data mining and copyright. There is a problem there. I think there is a problem because we have in copyright rights which are broadly defined, like the reproduction right. And data mining and text mining implies reproduction that in principle are covered by copyright. Because the reproduction right is disconnected from, I think, the economic nature of the act of reproduction. Many reproduction in the digital area are not linked to a true exploitation of the work. And that might be the case with data mining. So if you are a little bit utopian, you might then defend the idea that there should be some kind of condition into reproduction, right? And I've been working on that, but that's when you are asked as an academic to be a little bit forward-looking, that there might be a requirement to use a work as a work for a reproduction in the sense of copyright to happen. And that is not the case when you are making a copy for data mining or you are making a copy for using an anti-plagiarism software, that there are many other copies that are in principle covered by the reproduction right, for which there is no exception so far in copyright law. So you cannot avoid the issue by requiring that there should be some type of use which implies that you are using the work for what it is, and that is a means to communicate something with the public. Of course, if you are using a work because you make a copy just to check whether there is plagiarism, there is no, in that sense, a communication, I think, between the author and the public. So you might exclude by coming back to the rationale of the reproduction right. But I think probably we'll need a legislative fix, a new exception for data mining, and quite recently in December the Commission came with a communication towards a modern, more European copyright framework, and there they open the way to the introduction of an exception for text and data mining. Probably it will be quite narrow and too narrow, because it will only cover to users in the context of science and research. And probably that's what you have. I know that there is an exception already under UK law, but it excludes, as far as I know, commercial use. Maybe it's too narrow, because for the digital economy, for the exploitation of big data, you would need a broader exception. Maybe. I mean, that's my view. Another issue in relation to aggregation of content and hyperlinks. It's a complex issue too, but some of you know the case law involving, for instance, the Svensson case, where one company operates a monitoring service, and that's a defendant in this case. Svensson is a journalist. And retrievers send to its clients list of clickable links. The journalist consented to the online publication of the articles on the website of their newspapers, but they opposed them to reuse by retriever, which is reuse by hyperlinks. And the big issue there is whether there is a communication to the public under copyright law. Again, we have a definition in the directive, so the ECJ is competent to interpret what a communication to the public is, and the ECJ in this Svensson case came with two conditions. There should be a communication, but it's broadly defined, and a new public. And here there is no new public, because it's the same public which can access the articles directly onto newspaper websites or indirectly through the list of links that retriever is selling to its clients. So there is no new public, and the court concluded that there is no communication to the public for that reason. But the court is not as clear as that, because it adds some conditions. And for instance, a condition that, of course, this list of links doesn't circumvent technical protection measures, TPM. In another decision, they come back in Luxembourg with the requirement that there is a first authorization. So there should be an authorization to put online the content first. I think the whole debate here is wrongly framed, in the sense that the whole discussion seems to be about direct infringement. But the court mixed what is a direct infringement, so what is communication to the public, and other possibility to regulate the behavior by using indirect liability or by using the protection of technical protection measures. So, in a sense, the Court of Justice make a confusion by mixing the issue involving direct infringement with the issues involving the circumvention of technical measures and what is called indirect liability, which is outside the scope of the ECJ. I think it would be better to have a better distinction between the three. And I think that would help to solve some of the copyright issues along the internet and involving data. database, right? Now there have been cases as well, like the ImoWeb case involving a dedicated meta search engine, which offers, as you can see, a high number of search in real time, which include the ads that are on AutoTrack. AutoTrack is the source website, and they are offering car ads, second-hand car ads. And in a way, they sued for an infringement of the database right. So that involves meta search engines, and I think that is as well important for big data, probably. So in this case, InnoWeb used the search engine of the targeted site. So it's different than the general search of Google, which is developed by Google. But here, they are translating the queries on the meta search tool into the search engine of the targeted database. And they offer the same type of result. So is there a reutilization of the database in this case? You have here the definition in the directive, in the database directive, of what a reutilization of the content of a database implies. The court here concludes that there is a making available because there is some form of parasitical product that is offered by the meta search. And it's as well a making available to the public because anyone can use the meta search tool. Another case that you might have been following, the Ryan Air case, which was decided by the ECJ last year, early 2015. So that's a website, PER Aviation, which offers the possibility for consumers to search the data of low-cost companies, air companies, to compare the price and even to book the flights. And the commission then is paid to PR Aviation. They use an automated search in the data set linked to the Ryanair website. The Dutch court in this case decided that there is no copyright, there is no database right, which of course might be controversial, but that's the fact of the case law in the Netherlands. And then the Dutch Supreme Court comes with some question, because in this case, Ryanair, on its website, has some terms of use, which, as you can use, prohibit the use of automated systems, like the one used by PR Aviation, for commercial purpose. So it's about screen scrapping of data scrapping. That is prohibited when you look at the terms of use of the Ryanair website. And it seems that at least for the users, you have to accept. This contractual provision is contrary to the mandatory exception to the database right, because the database rights cannot allow the owner, the maker of the database, to prohibit the reuse of insubstantial parts of the database. And the question is whether Ryanair can make a claim based on the terms of use, and the Court of Justice says yes, because there is no protection of the database, neither by copyright nor by the database right, so it's outside the scope of the directive, and the court concludes that it's possible to use contracts. But of course, it's for the national court to decide, for instance, whether they are enforceable. But it's a little bit paradoxical, of course, because when there is no IP protection, then more contractual restrictions can exist. So it will be for the Dutch court to decide whether the contractual terms are enforceable. And it seems here that will be about the possibility to enforce a click wrap license, at least for the users of Ryanair. There is this click wrap license. It's unclear that the automated query by the aggregator, as well as to go through the click wrap window. Okay, but data scrapping is covered by otherwise different national laws, maybe trespass to chattel here. So it's an area probably where more should be done in terms of harmonization. But of course, we should avoid unhelpful legislation. There have been in some countries like Germany and Spain, as you might know, laws creating new possibility against aggregators, creating some form of right against snippets. So that's the so-called anti-snippets laws pushed by press publishers, among others. So it's a different difficult area, and I think the case law is struggling as well in different countries. I won't say more because time is passing and I have to stop about trade secrets, but of course the online platforms may enjoy the protection of trade secrets in relation to the data that they are collecting on their customers, on their suppliers, on the different side of the market. So that's as well something to factor in the analysis. Briefly, on data protection, I think one of the issues there is data portability, which is the right to reuse the data. And we will have, when the general data protection regulation will come into force, we will have such right to reuse data, which is a right justified by privacy, but in a sense as well, it's a Trojan horse for competition, because it might have far-reaching consequence if every data subject can claim the right to receive the personal data and, as the text says, in a structured and commonly used format, and has then the right to transmit the data to another controller. That might change the rules of competition on some markets, for some platforms. Of course, it's not always that easy to implement this, right? And I think there are some attempts, like the My Data initiative in the UK. I think I have to stop. I want to say something on the directive on contracts for the supply of digital content. It's only a draft directive, sorry, which came out at the end of last year as well, which is interesting because it shows that data are in commerce, because the scope of this directive covers contracts when you have a supplier supplying digital content, and when you pay either a price or you pay by giving your data. Of course, you have to be a little bit active by registering, for instance. But that shows that data are becoming a counter-performance in contracts. And I think we are starting to deal with data in contract law with this draft directive, which creates obligations. Again, obligations in the case of the termination of those supply contracts, because in that case, the supplier must take measure to refrain from the use of the counter performance and should allow the consumer to retrieve all content provided by the consumer, and again in a commonly used data format. So we see the legislator trying to solve some of the issues here in the context of contract and consumer law. So I went a little bit beyond data protection here, and I conclude. Well, probably it's really a little bit a mixed message so far, and I'm not sure that the message after the conclusion will be clear, because there are a lot of different things that I'll try to put together just to start to think about the role of data in the economy and in the law. So what should be redesigned? I think I mentioned some elements. I think for certain area of the law, like competition law, I think we should tighten the analysis by taking into account the real importance of data, and maybe there should be something about data dominance and what it could mean, which requires probably competition law to rethink some bits. On the other side, for intellectual property, there I think we should relax partly the barriers to access and use data. It's quite obvious for copyright and for the accession for data mining, maybe in relation to aggregation and hyperlinks used to aggregate content. There should be some clarification too there. Data scrapping in the context of database, again, something should be flexible enough, but maybe a little bit clearer, because we don't know, for instance, at all whether the contractual restrictions prohibiting the reuse of data are enforceable or not. And about the data portability, well, it's a new sector which might be maybe expanded. So that's about the area. What kind of regulation, what mix makes sense? I quite like what happened with the wrongly called right to be forgotten, so the right to be delisted by Google or by other search engines. And that's again about personal data, but it's about access to information online. I think it's an interesting mix of regulation where you have the principle which was defined by a court, in this case the Court of Justice of the EU, based on mainly, I think, fundamental rights and need to balance those fundamental rights. And then, of course, you have the compliance process, the application of the ruling, which involves partly self-regulation, because today it's Google, it's Microsoft, other companies which are deciding about the application of the right to be forgotten, about when some data should remain accessible or when it should be deleted, or at least not really deleted, but there should be a delinked to that information. It has, I think, worked more or less good, but it raises some issues because Google, Microsoft aren't the sole judge about what should be delisted or not, and there is no oversight. So for the 400,000 requests treated by Google so far since the decision of the ECJ, only the guys at Google know the criteria that they are applying to respond positively or not to a demand of the listing. Maybe there should be something to involve some form of adjudicators. So need for platform regulation, there I am a little bit more reluctant, and by that word I stop here. Thank you for your attention.